All right, welcome back. Let's get right into it. So one thing that I forgot to say in the first episode of this run is that I really like this game. Like, I certainly have some criticisms of it, criticisms I can have after having played it for so long. But it's definitely really stylish. It's got some pretty good polish on it. And when things go right, it flows into itself really well. It's a good blend of, tactical movement on the square grid and the deck builder style. It does feel like, fist to fighting combat, fights in tight spaces. Anyhow, we just got through what was basically the tutorial act of the game, and things are going to start getting a little bit more complicated soon enough. We can already see enemies that get more dangerous the longer the fight goes on. They keep getting more and more damage the longer you leave them alive. And this guy who ignores block, who is not incredibly relevant at the moment, but is relevant if you're playing a counterattacking build. This guy just goes straight through your counterattacks. In any case, we can do something fun right here. Yeah, we do need to still be quick, but we can certainly be very quick like this. Just march down the board with the help of our front kicks. There, get out of there. Doesn't matter whether it's a regular enemy or a lieutenant or even a boss, you get them out of the board, they're dead. And not really much else productive we can do at the moment. I could maybe close in on these guys a little bit more, but I think I might prefer to just let them come to me and open up a little bit more space behind them, perhaps. Sadly, counter is not going to be very good as the game goes on. You really need block supporting moves or like a really block focused build in order to make counterattacks work, especially as enemy damage gets, as you might expect, higher and higher in the end game. 8 block is just not going to cut it anymore in the end game. Counterattacking can be really good if you build into it, but that's definitely not what we're doing. It's just kind of be a dead draw in the late game as things stand, and we might even want to kind of get rid of some of our blocking cards as the game goes on, or just deal with it. I mean, the more our deck grows, the less likely it is we're going to be drawing those cards. Let's see. Looks like our combination of kicks is going to keep us pretty safe here. Yeah, so we can quick kick you. And then head smash for the kill. And then finally, with our last momentum, we can kick this guy away so that he doesn't punch us. Very nice. This run's going pretty well. I have had runs that have really felt awkward and bad at this stage in the game, so I'm glad that things are flowing this well for what's the first commentated run. Would be very convenient if I could get one of these guys over to this side, but I don't think I'm gonna manage that with what I have. Well, hold on. I can still use my emergency move. It might be worth sacrificing a bit of damage to try and set up a nice ring out for this guy. Kick him out the back of the van. So, for example, if I throw you, then I could spend one move to get 1 point to get over here. And then I would just need one to kick you again. So I wouldn't be able to get you all the way out of the van, but I'd at least put you in a position where you're more likely to do that kind of thing. So I think that means I can even spend a long strike on you. Like, just doing a quick addition. Like, this whole thing adds up to 3 momentum. I have 3 momentum right here, so I am going to be able to play my entire hand. That's a nice quick calculation you can do. So given all of that, given that my plan is to ring this guy out, it makes sense to focus as much damage as I can on this guy instead. One more quirk of how throwing works in this game. This guy's lying on the ground. Sadly, I can't attack him. Not without specialized cards that specifically target downed enemies. That is a little bit unfortunate. It's kind of an artifact of, like, a clash between the card building and the tactics at hand here. But on the plus side, now that he's thrown down, I can move past him. So hopefully, all things being equal, this guy should stand right here and try and attack me at 2 range. Yep, excellent. So now, I cannot just shove him out, but I might be able to shove him out next turn. So yeah, that should work. Yeah, in fact, actually what I can do is I can quick strike you. And I can even combo finisher into you, and that will get me in range to play Throat Punch. So because I have this extra attack in here that doesn't cost any of this bar, I just need this to be sufficiently high. That means I can play an extra quick strike here. So now I can get in range. And then Throat Punch you, and actually you're dead, so, you know, that works too. I'll take it. I was ready to shove him out the door next turn, but did not need to. Well, there's a regular old Throat Punch, unupgraded if I want it. Still pretty good. Should note that it says that, well, Oh, good. So I can mouse over the tooltip to keep it active once, but, it might be like a horizontal positioning thing. So it makes it kind of hard to point to part of a tooltip. I can't use the keyboard to select a card and then point at the tooltip. So that'll be a little bit awkward in the future, but that's okay. I will manage in spite of that, so to say. Anyway, so we've already seen some enemies with blocks. So you can imagine that an enemy with a lot of block would be hard to punch in the throat. That makes sense. But nonetheless, there's still a large component of enemies that don't block at all, which this would be pretty handy against. On the other hand, we could just take a surprisingly useful little card. It does 9 damage instead of 8, but it does it in 3 separate hits, so you actually get 3 combo out of that if you can play it. So that's pretty handy. Or this, which honestly has actually gotten me into trouble. Double-edged sword on this one. So it's free, but it's very, very needy of a card. So I'll probably skip that, and it's kind of a toss-up between either of these, but all things being equal, we're probably likely to be drawing other cards in our hand that are not Throat Punch, so we're pretty unlikely to draw 2 of these at the same time. So it's probably okay to have this bit of utility in our deck, because in all likelihood we will have something else that will get rid of block, and then we'll be able to Throat Punch, and that's pretty good. There's a lot of enemies that this is useful against, to stun them out of their behavior, that also don't have any block. So, we'll take this. Throat Punch is a good card. Again, we'll want to route towards the gym. Not any good incentive to go this way, so we'll go this way. Alright. So, this prison riot has escalated beyond what you might normally think of as a prison riot. These guys have apparently managed to overpower the guards, and I guess they actually are in full control of the prison. That doesn't usually happen, in video games. Usually it kind of seems like these guys are just kind of in their own garb, and they just have, you know, standard video game kung fu powers, but no, these guys came prepared. They're probably some of the meanest enemies in the game, honestly. They have built-in block, They do reasonably good damage and a shove, and that shove in itself can be dangerous. And, you know, 8 damage that you have to get through that regenerates every turn, mind you. Decent base health. They're honestly kind of a menace. I would definitely like to shove them over the railings if I can. That said, I think I have just barely enough to shove this guy out of the way. It's going to come at the cost of being on the wide side of the U to this guy. So, like, here's my plan that I'm considering. Front kick you, so I wind up here. Step, dash, and then push, so that way I can push him over the railing. That at least gets him dead. You'll come to me, but you're going to be annoying and stay at this end of this arena, and then I would honestly probably have to come to you, which is a hassle, but it would maybe be worth it in order to just get rid of this guy early, because otherwise he usually tends to take multiple turns to take out. I think that's reasonable. The other thing I could do, which is actually even a little bit better, come to think of it, is I could dash this way, emergency movement, and step. I'd have to play 3 movement cards to zoom all the way over here, and then I could play push, and I could push this guy over the railing. So the benefit of that is that you would then take your attack, and you would shoot this guy, and do pretty solid damage. I'd still have the same problem that he would be on the opposite end of the arena to me, and be trying to shoot me over Void. But at least I get a little bit of progress on this guy, and that seems pretty reasonable. I think this is a worthwhile use of the emergency move, especially on this difficulty. That's how it is in chess, you know. When you see a great move, keep it in the back of your mind, but keep looking. See if you can spot something even better. I actually had enough spare juice, I could have even front-kicked this guy. So, if I had done that, he would not be dead, but he would be in range of being dead. Anyway, we got a huge glut of enemies now. So, we might as well at least get started on killing them. Probably just gonna be most efficient to just go this way and then go to town. At least going this way is, well, it's supposed to encourage this guy to come over this way, but I think he's shy because these guys kind of have the way blocked. I was kind of expecting to at least go into this column, or maybe over here, but I don't know. Sometimes I just don't get what these guys are up to. Looks like... too bad I can't play all of these. That would be glorious, but I just don't think it's in the cards. Literally. Now, I think I can head smash this guy into the railing, and thus capitalize on this, at least. So if I slip... I don't need much damage to kill him, thanks to how good Throat Punch is. So I think I can slip. Oh, neat. So that actually doesn't take any of my combo away. So then, I can throw punch. And I think this works. Head smash. Yep. Onto the railing. Nasty. So that leaves these guys at low health that I can just deal with them this turn, probably. And indeed, it looks like I can. Now that I'm in this column, that should help encourage the shotgun guy to come to me, rather than hanging out and turtling back here. Which indeed he does. Very polite of him to step in step 2 range away from me, which normally would be safe. but not this time. Yes, so we will hammer fist, then step, and then throw him to the ground. Thankfully, we're not on a time limit for this mission. We're just kind of on an implicit one rather than an explicit one. Well, let's keep it up. Still have to grind away at his health. Okay, so now if we play Throat Punch too early, he will not be stunned with it, but at least it'll get rid of some of his block. So how much damage are we looking at here? 4, and then 4, and then 6, which is 14. He has 15 effective health. That's too bad. On the other hand, we have 2 movement cards, so we can skip this whole charade and just do the morally correct thing and kick him over the railing. Neat. These are all decent. We're kind of building towards an aggressive deck where we play a bunch of attacks per turn. This gets much, much better once we have more momentum and can effectively play more cards per turn. In which case, it'll be easier to get up to this 3 combo value. That said, our deck is going to be so big that the likelihood of us drawing this in early turns is going to be unlikely. So it's going to be more likely we'll draw it on later turns, where our combo value will probably be higher. So this would be a way of getting 8 extra damage and even more damage on later turns. On the other hand, this is a nice tool for just repositioning ourselves. It's kind of like a front kick, except that you can't play it at point blank. You have to play it from 2 away. But you get some pretty nice damage out of it, and you can shove yourself forward. So the decreased flexibility that it gives you is honestly probably a little bit annoying. But, like, the extra damage is quite nice. It lets you... having advancing cards that do a whole bunch of damage makes the fact that you're closing in on enemies safer. Like, you can use this to kill enemies, basically. So, kind of a toss-up here, but I'll go with Palm Strike. We're kind of having trouble playing as many cards as we would like. And it fits in well with our game plan, I think. Alright, what else we've got? This is basically a double quick kick. We can quick kick in both directions. This is... Well, it's a trade-off. It's cheap, but you pay in a different way. You pay with it being awkward to play at the beginning of your turn. There's that jump kick we just were looking at, so I guess we won't be buying that. Of all of these, I could buy both of these, or I could just buy the separate. Also, I have no idea how we wound up with, Oh, we wound up with extra, like, the weird $3 because of that, like, plus 15% money is, I think, what's doing that. So it would be either separate or push and save some money, I guess. I think we'll probably take push. Separate's decent. It's kind of a 2-for-1 almost, but it's pretty rare that I actually have 2 enemies on either side of me. I can get really good value out of that. It's really convenient to just be able to spend this with 0. Like, this is better in the early game. This is better in the late game. I don't think it really matters that much, but given that we want to spend get as many individual cards as possible, it's probably better for the challenge to get this card. Now then, we got any cheap upgrades in here? We do have a few. Some of them are decent. We could upgrade with a block. That would make it not a dead draw. Like, going from 10 block to 18 block actually really increases the amount of threats that it can deal with all by itself. And you can see with the way that this deck is going, attack, 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 that we are very likely to only be drawing one defense card at most. So turning this from something that is not going to be enough to block a whole bunch of attacks in the game to something that still doesn't block most attacks in the game, but it'll block like one attack from a decent member of the, like, decent numbers of the individual enemies around here, is pretty good. Like, this is not going to be blocking a boss attack, but it will block a minion attack, and that's probably enough reason to upgrade this. So I think that's a pretty solid upgrade, but at the same time, how likely, like, how much do I care about a dead draw in my hand? One card that doesn't do anything. Like, just the plain old fact that I could spend one block to... Like, I would be basically spending one on this instead of a movement card, basically. When we would normally have a movement. But, you know, just, I think this is pretty good. I think this is actually a pretty good upgrade. I'll take it. I'm kind of two minds about it, but I think it's reasonable to do. And we can maybe get up to some fun business with that. It's just, we're probably only going to get to play that once. That said, I'll probably consider it a success if the fight is going so well that I don't need that card, then, well, that's just, it just means that we're probably cleaning up house well enough that I don't need it. It's as simple as that. But that could come in handy in a jam. Trouble is, I just don't know if we're gonna grab it, draw it when we do need it. That's the trouble with these large decks. Okay, well, here's an example. This guy does 18 damage, 6 at a time, 3 times. So, the upgraded block would be enough to block all of that. Within 7 turns. I guess that means that we want to try and encourage you to shoot people out the door. But on the other hand, I have to actually get you killed in a reasonable amount of time, too. Surprisingly, this 6x6 map is actually one of the largest maps in the game, I think, if I remember right. So, yeah, no cards that shove enemies around, 2 movement. I guess we'll just hit you once, hit you again, and then move out of the way. Well, hold on, we have Vault. Vault does give us, well, we'd have to spend an... I don't think it's worth spending an emergency move to try and force Vault to be useful. So I think probably just Quick Strike, Head Smash, and then Shift here? Or Shift here. Or shift here. No, we want to shift here. We want this guy to kind of come to us. And he moves before you do, so I definitely want you over in this column. That's going to be better for business. Yeah, that makes sense. Things are going to get so much easier once I have 4 momentum. But with 3 things, you got to really pick and choose your stuff carefully. Okay, is it worth spending the emergency move to kill you now? I think the answer to that is yes. Yeah. Yeah, look at this. We have 6 enemies to kill in 7 turns. That's ridiculous, especially when one of them is a lieutenant like this. It's crazy. Alright, well, can't kill enemies that haven't spawned yet, that aren't there. In fact, actually, yeah, this actually went against me. I think I actually caused an enemy to spawn over there, which actually got in this guy's way, so he couldn't move over there, so he went this way instead. Because enemies can't move through other enemies. Yeah, this game is full of kind of little complicated little interactions like that. Now, it would be really convenient to be able to throw this guy to stop him from doing his attack, but unfortunately, he's in the heavy class of enemies. So, he's just completely immune to being thrown. I can't even play this card against him. I can't even, do 6 damage and avoid throwing him down to the ground. This is effectively a dead draw against this enemy here. Which is a bit of a shame, but it's just something that you have to be aware of. My options here are sadly not as good as they would normally be. I can't even really rely upon being able to shove somebody out this door next turn. So, given all of this, I think all I can really do is, hammer fist and push you, and then kind of move over here to prepare for trying to shove this guy out the door next turn, maybe. Yeah, bit of a shame, but that's what happens sometimes. You just get, no, we can do it in this order, though. We can push, and then we can hammer fist for one more damage. We'll just kind of go over here. So with any luck, well, no, this guy's probably going to wind up going in this direction rather than the other one. Let's do some science real quick first. No, that does not get rid of this guy's auto attack. So I can taunt. He's not going to do a regular attack in the enemy phase, but he still has this little symbol in front of him, which means that if I move or do an attack or basically take an aggressive action near him, he'll get an attack of opportunity if I'm standing there. So taunting does not get rid of that. Good to know. That's probably not going to come up again in this fight, but it's still good to know. Oh boy. Well, this is not a good, set here. I was hoping to be able to kind of shift behind this guy and kick him into range and get these guys in fighting, but I don't think that is going to happen. Step is kind of a lousy card. You don't really get to get up to a lot of shenaniganry with, this one. Sadly, since this is the non-upgraded throat punch, I also, can't, throat punch this guy, because he would block it. And if I play any attack in this situation, I'm standing in his attack of opportunity zone, his auto attack zone. So if I try to throat punch you or front kick you or do anything like that, he would react by bopping me in the head with the stick. I don't have any way of blocking that either, because I got rid of all of my block, or I'm drowning it out, essentially. I didn't get rid of any of it. So there's not much I can do about this. All I can really do is just step out of the way and get out of the auto attack zone and then do whatever I can from there. But I don't have anything that maintains distance. Both of these advance me. So it's just not a very good turn, unfortunately. Curse you, Step. Getting in the way of my fun. I could have stood there and maybe taken the 8 damage. That could maybe arguably have been better. There's just a lot going on here. So this guy is about, he's not going to attack. Even though he's doing the same pose, he's actually going to try and heal everybody up. You can tell that by mousing over him. Otherwise, the only thing you can really tell is that, he backed away from me instead of trying to get closer to me. And I guess, these kind of arrow markers show that he's up to something here. But they're kind of fist icons instead of question mark icons. So, yeah, the indications in this game could still use a little bit of work. But at least I can tell that he's up to something. And you can kind of remember that for future runs. So, yeah, enemy AI script's not always the cleanest, clearest thing. I cannot get in range of him, because all I have is slip right now. So I think I cannot get over to him to throat punch him to cancel that. On the plus side, I think this enemy's gain 8 health means that, they're not going to heal enemies past their maximum health, so I think it'll be a waste on all three of these guys, except he'll heal himself up. It would be nice if, when this was queued up, then you could see enemies' max health. That would at least clue you into how much healing they're about to receive, if any. Okay, alright, so given all of that, I think it would be convenient to be able to counter him and then get that 10 damage out by provoking him into, attacking me. Which I think I can, well, I can sort of do, but it's not really worth doing, especially when I can get 10 damage by just front kicking him appropriately. So we will just, actually we can do a little bit better. In fact, yeah, since I've got double front kick, here's what I can do. Throw punch first. That will pierce through his block, so this will actually work. If I had rollbacks, I would be able to actually show you, like, bad courses of action and, like, show off him being able to actually punch me. So maybe I should play on a lower difficulty next time. But you'll just have to take my word for it that he would bop me if I played around him wrong. So then we can front kick him twice. And now his friend will shoot him into the wall, which will actually kill him. Glorious. That's one fewer thorn in my side. I'm sorry, Chef. You can't feed a dead man. Alright. Still not very good options here, unfortunately. I do have the ability to block this guy's attack now, but it's not really that much use. He has the turn to face a player property, which is something that you'll basically only notice if you hover over him and remember that he has it once you take your mouse away. So, this game is full of things that you kind of have to remember. So if I, for example, pushed this guy and then stepped onto this square, he would turn over here and start attacking this way, and I would not be able to block both of those attacks. But it would be good to at least get started getting away from this wall. Especially since I have to come to meet this guy. Yeah, somehow I don't think we're getting this fight done in 3 turns. That's a really tall order, like I said. So I think it is going to wind up being something like strike, push, vault. And I need to push again and to get rid of this attack. I need to get you out of the way. So push again. And now block the whole thing. So now I've got at least a little bit more room to maneuver. Nice try. There we go. There's that palm strike. And we will have to get ourselves out of the way once all this is done. So probably just killing this guy off is the right call. So given that, I do need to spend all of these to do that with. Yes. Yes, I do. That's free. Then I front kick you. Now, he's not about to heal anybody, so I guess I could use the hammer fist on you rather than you. But I think I would rather just keep my options a little bit more clear. Just have one fewer attacker to deal with. And we can't block that this time, so we'll just get out of the way. Okay, good. Good. These are exactly what we want to see here. This is how you efficiently get rid of your bosses. Ooh, am I lucky? No, I'm not lucky. Darn. I was hoping he would just run up here and attack me, but I guess he's feeding the enemies again. Too bad. I could get him to cut that out. I guess in theory, if I taunted him, he would feed everybody now. That's a weird enough inter- Well, he would also feed himself. Yeah, I wouldn't want to make him do that. So instead, I guess it's just going to be something like front kick, and then throat punch, and then push. And that's about the best I can do. I don't have any way of kind of shoving him over in this direction and then out the door. So, yeah, very convenient that I can shut down enemy special abilities like that, too. Now he's just not doing anything. Although you can't stun an enemy out of being heavy. You can't stun the intrinsic qualities out of a person. Where would I like to be? What am I about to draw? That's always a good question when you're wondering where you should be at the end of a turn. It's at least worth taking a look at your deck. That's certainly a lot better when your deck is small and you're a lot more sure about what you're drawing. But you can at least take like a quick glance at the icons here to give yourself an idea of, you know, how much push do I have left in my deck? How much damage do I have left in my deck? Those kinds of things. How much range do I have left in my deck? So, with that in mind, this screen right here with all the icons in front of you looks like icon soup, but at least you can scan it to kind of see what you might be able to get down the line. So, it's pretty well put together. With that in mind, I think most of the stuff I had there was one range, although I had a few 1-2 range things still left to do. If I go right here, I'm going to wind up surrounded by two melee range enemies, which is not going to play to my benefit. Whereas having them catty-corner to each other works better for me. So I think standing right here is better. On the other hand... Wait, hold on. Who goes first? You go first. So if I move here, you are going to go here to melee me. And that's going to block the way... And I don't know what this guy will do. He'll either go back here, or he'll try and run up here to get a little bit closer to me, I think. Whereas if I stand right here, he will probably go back here to try and shoot me, instead of getting back up into the fray, which is what I want. So I am willing to take a bit of a risk here. I think the upcoming movement cards... like. Are mostly good enough that I should be okay here. Well, two of them are dash and step, which are kind of awkward and bad in this scenario. Yeah, that could get me in a bad situation, actually. Like, if that's my only movement. Wish my movement was a little bit better, but that's mostly the domain of other decks, not this one. So, given that, I think standing right here is better than standing right here. And that's, you know, an easy thing to overlook, but okay, I really don't know why he's going over here. He should be trying to melee me at this point. Enemies usually just, like, the only thing that they really care about is not standing directly in each other's threat ranges, mostly. Although I have still seen enemies kind of walk in and kind of intercept one another. Sometimes. So it's still kind of iffy. Okay, we've got some good options here, actually. In fact, this guy's actually low enough on health that we can kill him. Also, he zoomed past this objective like quite a while ago, but that's alright. Yeah, this costs momentum. This is free, so I guess we can just spend this. Sadly, I don't think we're going to be able to use it on you, which would be very attractive, but... Nope. We'll just get these guys out of the way. And we're probably not going to be able to kill you this turn. No. No, that is, that's okay, though. These are effectively the same. It's either 12 damage or 8 plus 4 damage. And then we can throw them to end our combo. Well, finish our turn, not end our combo. Alright, get out of here. Man, 11 turns. I think the objective was like 7 or something. Maybe even, yeah, 7 turns for 6 enemies. Yeah, that's harsh. There are ways to do that, but that was clearly a lot of health to go through. We would have had to have taken a lot better advantage of those doorways, which is easier said than done. Yeah, this can be neat. For whatever reason, it seems like enemies kind of are a little bit more prone to standing near doorways if you don't have a direct way of shoving them out of there. So you can kind of get some use out of cards like this to indirectly shove them out rather than shove them directly away from you. And it's upgraded, so it does decent damage again. This is really good when you have a ton of attacks. So late game, when you have like 5 or 6 momentum and you can easily be playing like 3, 4, 5 attacks in a turn, no problem, then this becomes really good. I don't think we really have the build to support it at the moment, though, so I think we take another Palm Strike here. Let's see. Got any more momentum rewards coming up in the distance? Oh, there's one. Yeah, see, that's such an unobtrusive little icon there, that third one there. And yet, it's one of the most important icons in the game, because it means you can take more actions. So, we'll be on the lookout for that in the future, but for now, we're on the lookout for money mostly, so I think we'll probably just take this route. This is a neat little bit of flavor. In this mission, we don't have to kill this guy. He's technically on our side. But he's still an enemy. Like, he will still attack us to maintain his facade. Because he's got to maintain his cover, you know. But if we can kill everybody else in the room, then we win. We don't have to kill this guy. On the plus side, that also means we only have 2 enemies to deal with and 8 turns to deal with them in. So, for some... Like, this is... Yeah, this is crazy. Like, we had 6 enemies to kill on the last mission, and the objective was to get it done in 7 turns. Here we only have 2 to kill, and we can do it in 8 turns, and we have a... Let's call him an ally, even though he really isn't, to help us out with that. So you... Plans are already forming in the mind of the tricky viewer who will surmise that one of the most efficient ways to get missions like this done is to have the informant go beat up his friends and basically tag team with this guy to destroy the room. And you're right, that can be very helpful, although I don't think we're especially well set up to do that at the moment. So sadly, I don't think we can really get a lot of infighting going on here at the moment. And I don't have a ton of damage in my deck right now. If I wanted to focus damage on this guy, it would look something like slip, push, front kick, and then quick strike, and I'd wind up here in the corner. I'd probably wind up surrounded. Whereas if I front kicked up here this way, I could use slip to get out of the way and go where exactly? It's not much better. All things being equal, I would certainly like to get rid of this guy, the auto-attack guy, because he kind of constrains my movements, but he's also harder to get rid of in general because he has more health and regenerating block. So, again, it's trade-offs. I think I'll probably go with you, because if I can get you down to low health, I can probably get you off by some other attack next turn, maybe. We'll go with that theory. So I need to keep one of these in reserve to get out of there. But I have it, because everything else here in my deck is cheap. Now, where would I like to go? Not the corner. Corner's bad for me. So we'll go ahead and go right here is good, I guess. We're going to wind up surrounded anyway, but we can probably deal with that. It's probably not good that we have... Or the enemy could just get in the way of the other one. That works too. Again, they're not super smart, these enemies. They're pretty greedy. They'll do whatever they like. So first, we need to get you out of the way. Yes, okay, this will work. We can get you out of the way. Now it's okay for us to stand here. So we can use this on you. And now, this is safe, because I'm going to front kick, advance here, and kick him. And then, when it's his turn to react, I will already be out of range of him. He'll be standing right here, his auto attack will be right here. I'm not going to be standing in there. That wasn't very much damage, though. We can be a little bit tricky here. In fact, yeah, look at this. They each do 8 damage. We can block all of that with one super block. And we can get a good combo here. Yes, yes we can. So block. Front kick you. He will react to that by bopping me, but I've got some block for it. Also, he can only auto-attack once per turn, so I would be safe to keep attacking in this situation if I felt like it, but I'm not. I can dash up here. I can take that other attack. I'm fine. I do not have enough to head smash. Right, I was supposed to use emergency move, not dash. Darn it, I got a little bit confused. That is a shame. Yeah, that is a shame. Oh well. We can still get away with this to a certain extent. Yes, we can. We'll do a very similar thing to what we did last turn. Look, we got to maintain our facade here. You know, nothing personal, buddy. Now then, yeah, long strike and like, yeah, so it's like 9 damage and 29, and that adds up to like 38, and I think that's enough. Yeah, that's enough. Using that long strike to stay out of his range, and then close in for the kill. There we go. So, same number of turns. Got a bit lucky that that worked out that way. But, that just goes to show, like, forgetting one tiny little detail of your detailed plan, your intricate plan, can really mess you up. This is decent. It's like an extra bit of movement. And it doesn't cost you any momentum. But it might be a little bit hard for us to work with. This is amusing, but we don't have enough momentum to really make good use out of it. It would take our entire turn right now. It's certainly a lot better when you have 5 or 6 momentum. Or some other way to cheat out the cost of this. But no, we'll just take another regular old strike. So there's a quick message there, enhanced targets. I didn't, hover over that for very long. That's just the game telling us that these guys are gonna have a little bit more health and do a little bit more damage than normal. Yeah, I think this guy was doing like 6 in the first mission. So, he's, thankfully these guys still have pretty basic behavior. I would love to front kick you over the walk. Also, I think this is the first briefcase we've seen. It's a nice little sub-goal to reward you for being able to move a whole lot and cover ground. And potentially put yourself in an awkward position. But if you can do that, then you will get a bonus to this meter. Which is sometimes hard to even reach, but with the kind of deck we're building, we could definitely reach this in some of the longer fights. So getting up to a 12 combo could really make cards like this real powerful. So given this opportunity to, kill an enemy instantly and work towards this goal, I think it's worth using our emergency move. Being explicitly rewarded as an objective for pushing enemies out of the board, it's kind of a weird decision that this game makes, because in theory, you would think that instantly killing enemies would be its own reward, but it can be pretty hard to get to that point in the first place. The fact that enemies can do that for you, like, this guy shoves with his attack, this guy shoves with his attack, you can make that work to your benefit to get enemies to shove each other off of the board. But there's some maps where that could just be really hard to do. Thankfully, this one has given us a nice gift. And then we can slip to get out of the way of this guy. We might not be able to get to the briefcase, but I am willing to give up that objective in favor of this one. And he would also be covering this square, so it's not like I can just go back here and throw this guy and be safe. So, gotta go over here, but that's okay. Who knows? If we draw enough front kicks, we might be able to make it to that suitcase regardless. Yeah, not seeing a lot of good stuff here. How much damage does front kick to you and then step here and then head smash you do? That would be, like, I gain one combo, I lose one combo. So this would do as much damage as is listed now. So that would be 6 and 18 is 24, which is not enough. He would get to shoot me if I did that. And that's not really damage I can withstand, so I don't think that's worth it for the briefcase. Chasing after the briefcase too heavily can get you killed. So we'll just accept that as lost. That's fine. Now it'd be really tempting to head smash him, but he would turn to face me, so don't do that. No, that's too bad. I don't even actually get to score any damage on him. Yeah, turns out in this game, wearing a helmet, pretty effective, pretty good idea. Actually, pretty helpful. I don't think we really have much else we can do here. At least I get to stun this guy twice. Stunning actually does stack. So he will actually be stunned twice. I forgot. You can actually taunt any enemy in the game. If I taunt him now, is he just going to shoot? Oh, that's convenient. Thanks. So, if I stun this guy once, he would wake up on this turn and, be active again. But because I stunned him twice, he's actually still active, stunned now. So, that's convenient. That's actually a good reason to go for multiple stuns. Also, I stunned him twice and he didn't regenerate his block either. Yeah, he's still there, not blocking. That's also convenient. That's a situation that doesn't crop up a whole lot. Okay, I can play my entire hand if I'm careful about it. How would I like to go about doing this? I do not have enough damage to kill this guy without using my combo finisher. So I guess I will do that. Yeah, that seems to make sense to me. So we'll do our wimpy attack on him. Then we'll do a slightly more damage to you. I guess I also could have done 6 damage to you, which maybe would have been worthwhile. Then I'll push. Or no, actually I can combo, well, no, I can't kill both of these in one turn. What am I thinking? So we'll push, and then we'll combo finisher, and then because I didn't play a movement card, that will actually, well, I was about to say it would be better for me, but I just finished my combo, so irrelevant. But it's worth thinking about these kinds of things. How can I get my combo to be one higher at the end of a turn so it's easier for me to play other cards later or stuff like that. Okay, this works out. I can front kick you. Shift over here all of a sudden. And then kick you off the board. Yeah, now see, again, he's a ranged attacker, but he's attacking me from point blank instead of from back here. And we all know that if you have a ranged weapon, like a gun, you don't get in melee range with a gun. That's just not the right way to do things. Unfortunately, I played my cards in the wrong order. I was supposed to quick strike this guy first. Oops. He's too busy coming up with a witty retort. I took one turn too long to kill this guy. What a pity. This is why you have to say your witty retorts when people are already dead. That's the practical thing to do. It's just so satisfying to say them ahead of time, though. This could be neat. This, when you draw this card, it's, kind of a dead draw, but in exchange, everything else is cheaper. So, ideally, I guess what you would do with this is you would either have a whole bunch of one momentum cards that you can play for free, or a whole bunch of, like, really expensive cards that are cheaper to play now. Basically, this card says when you draw this, you can play your entire hand. That's kind of how it works out to be. That said, we're surprisingly not having that much trouble doing that because so many of our cards cost one. But, I think I would prefer to just have an extra action or choice in my hand compared to being able to play all of my choices, easier, if that makes any sense. So, given that, it's probably okay to get another throw. We're not gonna be able to build around this, that's for sure. Like, it's just gonna be a random boon for some turn somewhere in our deck, somewhere. We can't really, search for it, fetch it, or recall it, or do anything deck manipulation style to get this out when we want it to, so it's just going to kind of randomly show up sometime. So, I think just having another throw would be useful. Okay. Standard one range and two range attackers we've seen before. This guy is our lieutenant for this chapter, and he's a counter-attacking enemy. So unlike the auto-attacking enemies that had attacks of opportunity whenever you moved into their range or did an attack to anybody around while you were standing in front of them, this guy doesn't care if I attack these guys. But if I attack him, he will counter with his own attack, which is both damage and a push. And that will happen an infinite number of times per turn. So he reacts to being attacked. That said, it is a one-range attack, so if I attack in such a way that at the end of the turn I'm not in his range, then he won't be able to counter me back. That's kind of your general rule for dealing with these guys. So, I can already see something useful to do. I can shove you out of here, either with the push or the front kick. And given all of this, I think the answer is save my movement so I can front kick you. We'll head over here. And much as I might like to head smash, it is going to mess up my, mess up this again, because he's going to change his facing. So I'm going to get some infighting going. There we go. Excellent way of dealing with counterattacking enemies. Just infighting. It's a reflex. They can't control it. Let's see. We are on a time limit. I'm just kind of saying that to myself more than anything. I guess we want to cause infighting again. Sure. Yeah, thankfully this guy doesn't have too much health. Counterattacking guys don't tend to have a lot of health. But he's still a lieutenant, so he does still have, you know, a lot. Just not as much as other enemies would have at this stage of the game. Of similar height and status. Also, he's a big guy, so I can't throw him, which is a little bit annoying, because that's one way you could deal with this, is they can't counterattack you if they're on the floor. Enemies is a floor game in this game are not very good. Let's see. We're getting there on this guy. Counter would let me block one of his pushes at least. I mean, I would block the damage. I can't block him shoving me, though. That's an important distinction. So, for example, if I slipped over here, then pressed counter, and then punched him, he would react with an 8 damage attack, which I would block the damage of, but then he would shove me, and I would go out the door, and I would instantly die. And, that's a run-ender, so, let's not do that. So I'm thinking counter quick strike so that he will counter me. I won't be able to counter him because he'll shove me out of the range of my own counter, which is one range. But then I would be able to front kick him, and so that would be a way which I could get 14 damage on him. These other guys are not really worth going after. This guy's too far out of the way, and this guy has too much health, but I'm just considering how I can get him low on health, so that way I might be able to kill him next turn, and as you might expect, killing the enemy, he can't counter if he's dead. So, yeah, that, of my options, that seems pretty good. In fact, yep, well, that was a little bit delayed. Usually, these things sync up, but not quite. In fact, since this is free, I can actually fit this in here. Get myself a little bit of bonus damage in. And then come back up here and front kick him. Okay, a little bit of a... Yeah, I think it might be that if you throw them down, they have to spend their entire turn getting up. I think they can't, like, get up and move in the same turn. That might be what's going on here. So, sadly, this guy didn't come over here to go beat me up, but that's also okay. This guy is weak enough that a regular old quick strike will finish him off. So, combo finisher into you. and then dash over here and then hit you and just kill both of you. That seems to work. I don't think I can get any real bonus damage here, can I? I think I can. So I'm thinking dash here, throw again. Pardon me. Throw here. Combo finisher still has enough damage left on it. I'll only lose 2 damage, so it'll do 16. That's still enough to kill you. So yeah. In fact, actually, yeah, it'll be dash throw. That'll get me one combo back, so this will actually be back to doing 18 damage again. I would have to use emergency move, but that's okay. Yeah, so that's so emergency move gets me here, and then quick strike, you. And then I just never use taunt. That all works. These extra bits of damage I'm getting on this guy are gonna pay dividends. And then I don't think it matters too much which of these squares I'm on. I guess I'll go here just in case, oh, no, he's not gonna move. We just established this. I could taunt you, I guess. That at least, well, it doesn't do anything, but it's funny. Alright, get up. Yeah, he's still over there. Alright, that's kind of what I figured. And I can't even get to him. Because all I can do is step. Alright, let's go for the throat. Ooh, these are some nice options. This is our first exposure to the bleeding mechanic, which is, damage over time. Think of, poison in other games, or, well, yeah, mostly poison. But we're too honorable to poison people. No, we would just cut them up instead. So this could effectively deal, 4 damage straight away, and then 6 plus 5 plus 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1 is 21 amount of bleed damage over 6 turns, which is 25 total damage for one momentum. That also ignores block. That's a pretty darn good card, even though we're definitely not doing a bleed build, not even close. This is also a 1-1, like, one range, one momentum cost. 16, a little bit less than this first one, but it means when we gain block next time, somewhere down the line, even on later turns, we'll get some extra block for it, which would increase the amount of attacks that are kind of understated blocks would be able to keep us safe from. But that said, I think we're going for maximum damage. I guess there is something to be said for the fact that all of this damage is front-loaded, whereas I have to wait for a lot of this damage. But being able to do damage through block can be useful for just straight-up killing enemies, too. And then there's this one, which is a combination of movement and... movement and damage. But it only works if you can throw the enemy. And you also have to be, the tile behind them also has to be clean, too. So there's a lot of restrictions around playing this. But it's also quite handy because you can just move yourself around more. And as we've seen, having attacks that also move you enable all kinds of crazy plans and synergies and whatnot. Again, if we had a tiny deck, I would be able to plan around this a lot better. But we have to go with attacks that are good all on their own. So, I think it comes down to puncture or roll throw here. And we already have a bunch of throws in our deck, so I think we'll just go with puncture. That seems pretty good as just a lone card to draw into. Oh boy. These things usually go a little bit faster when I'm not explaining every last little thing, but that's alright. Now, I think going this way, we're going to give up the gym, but I think going this way just so that we can probably win the run. Like, we still have to win the run, of course. Let's go seek that momentum boost. That way we can do even crazier plans and take even more actions per turn. Okay, game. What do you want us to do to get that bonus? Just complete it within 8 turns. But we have 5 enemies to kill. That could be a tall order. Hopefully we can just shove these enemies off the board and get the job done that way. We'll see. That could be tough. Let's see. Yeah, you're facing this way. I think I can actually just taunt you into stabbing your friend in the back. Man, that's a lot better than I gave it credit for. It's free, too. Because as we all know, talking is a free action. Yeah, not much else to do here. Okay, will you? Yes, you will let me front kick you. In quite a friendly fashion, might I add. Then I think we can slip and get one more hit in. No, it's not quite that. We're not going to be able to do Palm Strike this turn. Nah, that's a bit of a shame. No, unless we use Emergency Move. Funnily enough, we actually don't want to kill this guy. This is another mechanic I should probably explain. If I don't do anything in particular, this guy is at least smart enough. He's waiting for target, you can see at the bottom of his little window there. So if I, like, end my turn right now, or if I go back here and do nothing, he's not just going to shoot his friend for no reason. However, if I move him, or if I get into his range and then get out, then he kind of becomes activated in a manner of speaking. You can kind of see that with the like the fact that the little number 2 at the top of his window indicating his attack order is kind of grayed out here. He's waiting for a target. This guy had an attack target. He was trying to shoot me at the beginning of this turn. He's kind of active and aggroed, I guess you could say. So he's got a red number 4 there. He would shoot if he had anybody to shoot. If anybody were in his attack range, he would shoot them. But because there's nobody there right now, he's still not going to shoot. This is a lot of subtle things going on here. So I think the answer is emergency move, because this is free, unlike this one, which costs 1. That lets me play 2 attacks. And then I can palm strike, and because of that, I need to not be standing in this guy's way, because if I go here and kill this guy, he will then have a line of sight on me and shoot me. So I have to go here, and then do all of the above. Do this, do this, and even though I'm out of energy, it would look like I'm flat-footed, I can't use slip, I got my combo up high enough that I can play this, kill him, and I'm fine. And I got my bonus for next time. This is the kind of nonsense you have to think about in order to get to your get those enemies killed in time. Thankfully, those are all the enemies we have to deal with. Yeah, there's 2 dead and there's 3 on the board. This guy's annoying. Thankfully, he doesn't do that much damage, but he's definitely a huge time sink. If I fail to get this objective done in time, it's probably going to be because of him. Although that said, he's just as vulnerable to being pushed over the railing as anybody else. But if I wanted to do that, I would get shot, and I would prefer not to. It's just bad for business, you know? So I'm thinking something like Vault, Palm Strike, and then Combo Finisher on you, and that's about as good as it gets. I could Vault Push, no, I can't Combo Finisher into Palm Strike because this ends the combo, so... No, I have to do this while I'm still at melee range to him. But I could do Vault, Palm Strike, Push. That gets me one more combo, which I can do this with. That does a little tiny bit of extra damage, and now I can throw, and that should kill him. Okay, there we go. And I'm in a good spot for dealing with this guy. I'm up in his face. He'll have no choice but to attack me from point blank, and... Darn. I was hoping I'd be able to just shove him over the railing, but no such luck. Interestingly enough, I can block both attacks this turn if I play the block. But, I might have better options. Yeah, such as, for example, a super powerful throat punch. Yeah, I have a ton of attack modifier. In fact, actually, I think I got a palm strike off earlier, like a regular one, and I think that gave me +2. And then I got another one off, which gave me +3. And I think those modifiers are not getting deleted or refreshed or reset. Yeah, that's the word. The turn after they go off. So I think I just get to keep these for the rest of the fight. That's nice. So basically the calculations I'm trying to do is that puncture would go, it goes through block, ignores block, but what that also means is that it ignores this mechanic where, he can't be harmed from the front. Like, I think puncture would go around that. That's a nice little bonus. So that would be one way in which I could kind of, get some damage going on him. On the other hand, I think just getting rid of you... would make my life a lot easier as far as dealing with this guy is concerned. So I think I might prefer to do that. Because, like, step, puncture, block does get the job done. I would get hit by you and then shot by you. But I would survive all of that and I'd wind up back here. Like, here, here, here. But that's not very inspiring. Whereas I could kill you outright, I believe. I think. 42 health is a lot, but... I think this is... Well, it'll at least get me on the road to doing all of that. Yeah, you're not gonna die this turn, but... oh, no, actually you will. Yeah. He's got 6 bleed on him. He'll bleed out. Okay. I guess the pure damage is better than I gave it credit for. Alright. So this is why this guy is annoying. You need really specific kinds of, movement to kind of get around his block, his front block, and I just don't have that right now. My best options are to try and kind of lead him around somewhere, or to throw him, because throwing goes through this kind of mechanic. He can block me trying to punch him, but he can't block me trying to grab him. And you don't get the damage pop-up for that when I'm throwing him, but you do get it as kind of like a consolation little tag after the animation finishes, which is a little bit weird. But it's fine. How much push do I have in my deck left? Some? In fact, actually, yeah, I have 3 of these, and I'm guaranteed to draw 5 of these cards, so there's actually fair odds I'm going to draw 2 forward pushing cards here. But I forgot about the fact that it doesn't move. Darn it. Nope, I should have been right back here. I hope I can head smash him. It's worth a try. Okay, nice. Nice, that works. That goes through block. Front block. Front immunity. Okay. I'll take it. This is interesting. It might be a long time until we draw it, though. This is something you really want to draw on turn one or turn two if you can. Honestly, I don't like a lot of these cards. Like, this is the opposite of the goal we want. We want to use our combo for damage rather than block, so never mind that. This is decent. Like, at worst, it's a dead draw. This is also decent, although it's not amazing. It's a lot better if we have, like, multi-hit attacks, of course. And it's free, I guess. There's that to be said for it. So I think we'll take Snap Strike here. Like, Broad Shoulders is just a big investment for us to do. Even though we have 4 momentum. I guess it should also be noted that this applies to all push collision damage everywhere. So that means that if enemies shove the other ones around and they shove an enemy, like an enemy shoves an enemy into a wall, that also makes them do 4 more damage. And if an enemy gets shoved into ourself, they will do 8 damage to the enemy and 8 damage to us instead of 4 to each. So there's that risk as well. That said, most of our attacks don't shove. If we were going for a really shove-heavy deck, this would be amazing. I don't think it's good enough with our bloated deck strategy, our bag of tricks, our 50-card deck. So I think we skip out on this and we just take this. This is good with everything. And even if it's not specifically good with the cards we draw, it's at least a free, like, 4 damage in a lot of situations. So with that in mind, we'll go ahead and go here to try and get another card, and then we'll finish up. This is perhaps the type of mission that we were expected to do before I ran into the informant. Here's somebody to protect who is, not completely useless, but mostly useless. He's very specifically the British ambassador. Interesting. So he does not move. He's basically just an obstacle. And enemies are sort of interested in attacking him, but not especially so. They're a lot more interested in attacking me than they are in attacking him. That took a long time to figure out. Enemy's behavior with respect to the ambassador is a complicated topic that I don't fully 100% understand myself, but I'm starting to get the hang of it. Anyhow, sadly, we don't have a ton of opportunities to head smash here, and we can't move him somewhere where head smashing would work, so I think the best we can do is just throw punch, hammer fist, and go somewhere else. Although I would like to just shove him straight out the door. And, well, yeah, I think that's about the best we can do. I think if I understand enemy behavior correctly, they all kind of want to pathfind around this way to get to me. So let's see if I'm correct. And then, all things being equal, it's probably actually best to hang out here. Just because I would prefer not... Well, in theory, now that I have 4 momentum, I should draw enough damage to kill this guy next turn. So I would like some opportunity to, like, get a little bit of damage in on you if possible. So I guess I should go this way. Okay, no, he actually does want to attack, the ambassador. Alright, fine. Maybe I don't fully understand yet, then. Yeah, so, the way you're supposed to deal with, situations like this is to either prevent this attack from going off, move the, ambassador out of the way. Thankfully, he is, That phrase there, will not move or take damage from player attacks. What that means is, those are supposed to be 2 separate clauses. Like, you can move him with your attacks. he just doesn't move on his own. So that should probably actually be two separate sentences. Will not move, will not take damage from player attacks. Because, like, if I can get there and I can push him, then he will move. So given that, we can actually... If we really wanted to keep him from getting decked for 13 damage, which is actually quite a lot, that's nearly half his health, what we would do is shift, emergency move, push, get him out of the way. That would also open up a route for this guy to get to me, and then he would probably leave this guy alone and start closing in on me. On the other hand, if, you know, he can take a hit. It just says protect the ambassador. It doesn't mean... Never let the ambassador get damaged. He just has to survive the fight. And we'll get credit for this. And credit is not even, like, money or something. The ambassador patches you up after the end of the fight if he survives. So, it's not the end of the world if he dies. You know, it's an occupational hazard. But, you know, we're a classy agent. We should probably be able to keep him alive, and it would help out our score. So it's that kind of consideration, you know? It's that sort of prioritization of objectives. Anyway, back to the plan. If I can get 2 damage on you and then shove you over here, then you would kill you off. So for example, I could shift, quick strike, push... If I wanted to not use the push here, but use the push here, then I could get you killed. On the other hand, I could push and then combo finisher, because I would be up to 3 then. And I think, yeah, I would have 14 damage on this, and that would get you killed. But then I would have a whole bunch of movement and not really much else to do with it. And given that the way that this is kind of bottlenecked up, I think even if I go this way, he will still prefer to attack the ambassador rather than try and get to me. I think it's mostly that. I think if an enemy has the ability to reach either you or the ambassador, they will prefer to go to you, is I think what I'm trying to think of. So I think we do need to defuse this situation. And given that, I think quick strike, combo finisher, shift, emergency move, push, I think that all works. Yeah, okay. We will get to eat our cake and also have it too. And before you ask, no, that doesn't count as pushing an enemy out of the board. They just ragdolled out of there. Good ol' emergency move. Sometimes you just have to be able to move twice in one turn. Man, I'm getting a lot of mileage out of taunt this game. Okay, I think they're gonna leave the ambassador alone. Okay, good. I mean, good, I say, as I'm surrounded. So I think the call here is... Yeah, if I push you and then front kick you, I'll crunch you into the cabinet, and that'll get rid of you. So that leaves me free to do something like, yes, this will work. Quick strike... Then push. Now I'm up to 3 combos, so now I can also get the palm strike on you, where it matters. And finally, front kick to get out of the way and kill you. There we go. I love it when a plan comes together. Okay. We don't have any attacks that move us, so I can't, get into step here, beat this guy up, and then also not get shot by you. Which is a pity. Yeah, I don't have any way of dealing with that, so all I can do is long strike. Which is not nothing, but it's a lot less than I was hoping for sure. At least this guy is kind of going to... Oh, well, he's not going to come here. He would prefer to shoot me at range. Fine. That's actually good, because now I can go up here. And I don't want him to try and shoot me from across the table, so I think, all things being equal, this is the correct place to go. Thankfully, enemies are very, very considerate and will only shoot in straight cardinal directions. I'm loving this front kick, though. It's getting some work done. Okay, coming up on that timer, but I think we can get this guy killed this turn, hopefully. 8 block, 8 health, I think we can make that happen. Well, especially if I draw Head Smash this late in the game. That man is extremely dead. The helmet's not gonna save you from that. Interesting. Here's another movement tool. Extremely, movement tool here. And, another... a more modest movement tool. And something that makes our blocks better, but is actually probably worse than that reflex strike we saw earlier. Although, again, there's no requirement to hit an enemy with it. You can just play it whenever. I should note that two conditioning means that the next two times that you gain block, each of those individual instances of block will gain 50% extra block. So it doesn't stack on a single instance of block, it stacks in that you can play multiple block cards, and each of them will multiply your block. Which is arguably more useful, especially since this effect persists after multiple turns. So it's kind of a toss-up between charge and shoulder throw here. I might take charge. We're starting to get at the point where being able to chase down those ranged attackers would be useful. It does count as an attack, though. And it's expensive, of course. But you can play it against anything. Like, you don't have to be able to throw an enemy in order to play this. I'll take it. I think it fits in well with our build. We kind of want to get in range of enemies, and this lets us do it. It's only going to let us do it once, but it will let us do it. So naturally, the boss of the prison riot, as you might perhaps expect, is somebody in maximum security, of course. And he's unfortunately not very sophisticated. The game is deliberately vague as to what his activities are as the boss, but he attacks with a headbutt. He is the hard-headed man. And he's got a lot of health. Now, he also has that auto-attacking mechanic, but he combines it with turning to face the player. So the effect of this is, unless you have some way of playing around that, you can't attack him at one range without him counterattacking. But he only gets to do that once. Any sort of ranged ability or ability to stun him, for example, will disable this mechanic, and then you can just wail on him. So, I believe he also spawns with these two guys. I think these guys are guaranteed spawns at the beginning of this fight. And they are also very annoying. They make it hard to deal with the situation. They definitely jam things up. They crowd you. So given all of this, probably what we want to do is throat punch the boss, quick strike him, and then move somewhere else, so that we just move out of the way of this. All things being equal, we do want to be able to have access to this guy. Starting next to him can be very valuable, as long as you aren't also surrounded by other enemies. I should also note that we're on a very, very soft time limit. If we beat him fast enough, we'll get some free healing, although we don't need it yet. We're generally encouraged to get this fight done relatively soon in order to get points and to keep things from getting too complicated, but it's definitely very telling that it's annoying enough to hurt this guy that they made the time limit this long. Anyway, if we can at least get 12 damage in on the boss, then that's decent. There are certainly turns where you don't get that much damage in on him at all. Some turns you just can't even attack him. We can also do a head smash at this point, and it probably behooves us to do that. Oh, nice. We even drew another throat punch. This might actually go real fast. Okay, we do have to play this first to get rid of the auto attack mechanic. But then, we can at least get a little bit more damage in on him. Okay, now where would we like to be? We are about to, if we stay right here, we're going to get surrounded by this guy and a shield guy. Whereas, if I slip over here, then we will probably create a situation where this guy is standing right here and the boss will probably stay right here and want to attack me. And then when I move out of the way, this guy will headbutt the boss. So that is probably a little bit better. Okay, this is working more or less as I expected. Sadly, our movement options aren't that good. But they're okay. It's just too bad I'm not gonna be able to play either of these cards. As nice as they are. If I try and palm strike this guy, the boss is gonna headbutt me in the back, and that's really gonna hurt. It's also a shove, so it would do 19 damage. And we cannot afford that. We're not that desperate to get the fight done that soon. So, I think what we will do is just move out of the way and do nothing. Let events play out. This guy's attack is a maintain distance type of attack. So, he stayed where he was, effectively, after that was done. So the boss didn't get a chance to, auto-attack him. Let's see. This is a special. I think this means that since it's not an attack or a movement, I think I'm allowed to play this, and, he's not going to, auto-attack me for this. If I had a rollback, I'd feel a lot more comfortable just playing this now. I think I can get away with this. There we go. Sneak in a little bit more there. I would love to front kick him as well. And I can do that because I have a ton of push in my deck. In my draw. In my hand. Slowly but surely, we're chipping him down. This is definitely a deck where we do a lot of small attacks, not one big giant attack. Good. He went right there. And I think the play is... we can at least hammer fist you at range after we're done with all of these, and we can throw you after we're done. So, who's good to palm strike? I guess you, while I have the chance. Actually, I could have blocked. Yeah, I actually could have blocked. I could have blocked first and then palm struck the boss. That would have been a little bit better. Yeah, that's too bad. I didn't think of that in time. Okay, then we will just have to settle for this. And after all of those attacks are played, I at least have 6 combo to fuel this with. Okay, there we go. There are some good cards. We want to do as much damage as possible to the boss. In fact, we might even be able to kill him this turn. Well, we definitely will. Yeah, in fact, we have shift. Yeah, this is glorious. I think we will just barely get the kill. No, I'm not sure about that. So what I'm thinking is shift, kick him into here. He will turn around. He does have the turn to face the player mechanic. Thankfully, well, hold on. I can't remember whether this is correct or not. I think, I'm not 100% sure. If I shift, he has to turn around and he has to waste his action doing that. And he's not going to get to auto-attack me, like, he won't turn around and then auto-attack me and then headbutt me. If I had the rollback, I could test that, but since I don't, I can't test that. So the safe thing to do would be to just quick kick him and then front kick him and, I don't know, probably do some other stuff in the meantime. But that would at least get me 14 damage and then I could kill him next turn. If I shifted and I could get away with that, if he didn't auto-attack me, then I would quick kick him for 6, and I could front kick him into this guy for 12, and that would be 18 total, and that would not kill him. Okay, that question answered. So I can't kill him this turn. Not without taking damage, at least. Yeah, I would... well, I would take damage and then I would heal it. I forget how much healing this is, but it's not nothing. So, I would technically get more score if I killed him now. I think this might even be 20 heal, I'm not sure. If it's not, it's at least, like, 15, probably. I'm gonna try it. If that's the case, I'm... yeah, this is still effectively 12 damage. Okay, this is extremely greedy, but I'm gonna go for it anyway. I think this will heal me to full. Yeah, 20 health. I'm correct. I took 19 damage from that and I healed 20. Excellent. Okay, what do I want? This is decent for a huge deck like mine where I might just draw the wrong stuff. And this is basically regression to the mean, so to say. This is nice. We're going to be picking up a whole bunch of cards, so turning all of those cards we take into upgraded cards will be really nice. And this, if you're having a weak first few turns where you can't get your combo raised up, then this just puts you into good combo zone where you can play all your good combo cards. Given the theme of this run, I think this is appropriate. We're going to be snatching everything we possibly can, so getting a whole bunch of upgrades will turn most of our deck into upgraded cards. Oh boy, yeah, so that took a while. I wound up explaining a lot more than I thought I would, but, well, it was valuable. Commentary is the whole reason we do this kind of thing, after all. Next time, Jade's staff.